Very much. I'm going to go ahead and call this meeting to order. So if everybody can please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everybody, and welcome to the November 18th Planning Commission meeting. Can I roll call, please?
Commissioner Bergman.
Present.
Commissioner Gutierrez.
Present.
Commissioner Marsters.
Present.
Vice Chair Silberman.
Present.
And Chair Harper Pedersen.
Present. Okay, thank you. Now we're going to move on to public comment, and public comment is limited to items that are not on the posted agenda. So is anybody here to speak tonight on an item not on the posted agenda? Okay, seeing nobody, we will go ahead and move on to the approval of the minutes. We have two dates to approve, October 21st and November 4th. Commissioners, did anybody have changes or additions to the minutes?
I think I've done it again. I have the October 21st minutes, and I reviewed those, but I haven't seen the November 4th minutes.
They were attached if you got the paper packet.
Okay.
Yeah. They were stapled together.
Oh, I read them, and I didn't realize I was going to two separate dates. That doesn't speak well for me. All right.
The meetings blended together?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. Does anybody else have any changes or additions to the minutes?
I don't think it's technically the minutes, it's actually the agenda, but reading the minutes caused me to remember that the agenda, there's a small error just for the record. The agenda indicates that the Shelford Avenue matter, it was continued from October 21st to a date uncertain, and actually the minutes indicate correctly that it was specifically continued to today, a date mm-hmm. certain. So
right.
I just want the record to reflect that the agenda should indicate that it was continued from October 21st to a date certain, but I don't have any issues with the minutes.
Okay.
Any reason we can't approve both of them at the same time?
None that I
well,
know of.
Well, I'm going to abstain from November 4th because I wasn't here. But
okay. So I'll start by moving approval of the October 21st minutes.
Okay. Second for that?
Second.
Great. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you. Can I get a motion for the fourth?
Move approval.
Can I
second.
Get a second? Great. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. One abstention.
Great. Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you, guys. Now we have an item of new business, which is 40 Pine Avenue, and that is a Mills Act contract. Lisa, are you going to walk us through that? Thank you.
Good evening, Chair Harper Pedersen, Commissioners. My name is Lisa Porras, Principal Planner for the City of San Carlos. The item before you tonight is a proposed Mills Act contract for the property located at 40 Pine Avenue. I wanted to spend some time tonight to go through a little bit about what is a Mills Act contract. I believe this is the first of any contracts to come forward before the City of San Carlos to take advantage of what I think is a great program that's offered by the state for the preservation of historic property. So I'll get into a little bit about the Mills Act and what properties are eligible. I'll also provide the commission with a description of the property at 40 Pine Avenue, a little bit about some of the character-defining features of the home. I have some photographs for the commission as well. I'll talk about the proposed work program, which is by necessity a requirement for properties entering into the Mills Act contract. I also want to touch upon the fiscal impacts to the city as a result of entering into a Mills Act contract. and then just hit upon a couple of general plan policies that are consistent with this type of proposal, and then conclude with staff's recommendation. So the Mills Act is a program offered by the state of California, which is handed down to local jurisdictions to implement, but it was enacted by the state of California back in 1972 to preserve historic properties. And basically what it does is it essentially what it is it's an incentive program, and it offers property owners a potential of a property tax savings in return for preserving their homes. So the idea being that if you save the money that you save on property taxes that you would otherwise be paying could now remain in the hands of a property owner for the upkeep, restoration, and preservation of their historic resource. So the Mills Act is for property owners who are actively rehabilitating their properties or have a plan to do so. And the project before you tonight is proposing a plan to preserve and rehabilitate the historic resource located at 40 Pine Avenue. Now, I would like to mention, just for educational purposes, that the property tax reduction is not a guarantee. So usually you're going to see a property tax reduction if you bought your house, you know, within the past 10 years or so. For example, if you were to have bought your home many years ago under Prop 13, where you may be paying a very low property tax interest rate, through the Mills Act, the county reassesses the property. So it's reassessed, and then the property tax reduction could potentially be the outcome. Properties that do enter into Mills Act are reassessed annually and also inspected by the city to ensure compliance with the work program. So properties that are eligible are those that are listed in the National Register of Historic Places. Clearly being listed in the National Register is one way a property is eligible. It could be a property located within a historic district. Now, the city of San Carlos doesn't have a historic district, but if one were developed, even for a property that may not be significantly historic, it could be contributing to the historic district overall and thereby be eligible for a Mills Act contract. It's also for properties that are listed in any state, city, county, or city and county official register for architecturally significant sites, places, or landmarks. As outlined in the staff report, this particular property was reviewed in 1991 by the San Mateo County Historical Association through a joint project with the city, and it was deemed that it was eligible for listing in the California, in the National Register. And then in 2009, an additional survey was done, and then with this application, because this is the first project being brought before the City of San Carlos for Mills Act, we had the site be peer-reviewed by a qualified architectural historian, and that documentation is also provided in your staff report. Staff has also consulted with staff members from the State Office of Historic Preservation, explaining the situation that we received our first application, that the city hasn't officially adopted a Mills Act contract, but we do have supporting city general plan policies in place, and they said certainly that if it is listed, it has been listed, then it's certainly eligible should the city decide it wants to enter into a Mills Act contract. So the property at 40 Pine Avenue is essentially a 2.5-story Victorian home built in the 1970s. I believe on the DPR forms included in your packet, it lists 1874. And it was the home of Nathaniel J. Britton, who was very instrumental in the development of the city, as the DPR form state, and had a lot to do with how San Carlos evolved. Not only by the site, you know, being a place of historic significance because of its association with important events and people, it's also merits historic preservation due to the materials and workmanship that are still present on the house today. Some of those items include the original French ceramic roof tiles. There's elaborate detailing throughout the building, though additions and modifications have been made over the years. Many of those features are still present, which include the carved wooden pediments, which is essentially that low-pitched gable above the principal window openings, its brackets and finials, which are those ornamental features at the top of a spire or pinnacle. It has the site exhibits the original masonry work around the garden areas, the walls for that. The main entryway consists of a very significant sized wooden door with wood from Normandy. And there's original stained glass features on one of the elevations. So now I'll just kind of present you with a couple of photos that I happened to take of the property during a site visit. I wasn't able to get in the backyard and around some of the areas where photographs are shown in the DPR forms in your packet, so we're just going to be looking at the primary elevation and side elevation. I also took a couple photos of the garden area. So this is the primary elevation. This is another depiction of that elevation. As you can see, it's showing those original French tile roofs. Many of the tiles, in fact, I think all of them are still present on the structure. This is just a view as you go deeper into the property, you begin to see this side elevation and balcony area. This is a view looking at that side elevation as standing in the garden area. Here's an example of the side elevation, which exhibits the original stained glass in this set of three windows here. And this is some of the original masonry work on the site as viewed in an area that I believe was once a tea garden for Nathaniel Britton. And it has this old stonework leading up to, I believe this might be the pond or the well. And I believe the owner is here tonight, so she might be able to answer lots of questions and provide you with much more detail about the house as she's experienced living in it. So the work program, which I mentioned before, is a necessary part of a Mills Act contract. In Mills Act contracts, the owners are required to provide a schedule of work that they will do within a 10-year period of time. I should also mention at this point that once the owner enters into the contract, it runs with the land in perpetuity. Even if the owner were to sell the property, the new owner would be required to comply with the Mills Act contract in place. There are provisions to come out of the contract, and certainly if no work is being done, then the city has recourse to remove the property from the benefit of the property tax reduction, and there's actually even a fine imposed on the property, which I believe is 12% of the assessed value of the home. So the owner, Patricia Freidenbach, has proposed the work program in front of you. This is included as, I believe, Exhibit C to the contract. She wants to rehabilitate the pond in the front yard. She wants to actually restore, not preserve, the windows. Restore being keeping with the original material and character of the window. To do some restoration of the historic well, to restore the balcony, to do landscaping work, restoration of the carriage house, and then general maintenance throughout the life of the contract. One of the things that's very important to note is that now that this project, I shouldn't say now, it could still be the case today depending upon the level of work, but because the property would be in a Mills Act contract with the city, that any work done to the site needs to comply with the Secretary of Interior Standards for Treatment of Historic Property. And the Secretary of the Interior provides guidelines, very detailed guidelines and standards based upon the type of work that's being done, whether that's preservation, restoration, rehabilitation, or reconstruction. There's no reconstruction here, but any of the work that's done, exterior alteration and that sort, would receive a higher level of review than might otherwise be required. You know, certainly property owners can replace windows, but for this particular property, if work was to be done on a window, then the proposed method for restoring or replacing that window would need to be done through design review so that staff, via a qualified, you know, architectural historian could review the type of work being done and make sure that it's consistent with those Secretary of Interior standards. For this property, staff consulted with the county, with the county's tax assessor's office to determine what the potential property tax reduction would be for this property. For this current tax year, the general tax rate is $14,659, and the city's share of that is 13.27%, which means that a total of $1,945 of the total 14,000 property taxes that are being paid are the is the portion that comes to the city's general fund. With a $5,000 reduction, again, this is estimated because it doesn't actually happen until the assessor goes through the formula and determines what it will be, but the county is able to provide estimates for jurisdictions that are considering entering into mills out contracts for this project or property. It would be $5,000, which would reduce the city's share from $1,945 to $1,281, resulting in an annual loss of $663 to the city. Oh, and I see what you mean. Commissioner Silverman had asked a question earlier via email about the reduction, whether that was to be annually or biannually. So that would be, if it's it would be a total reduction of 663, about thereof, estimated annual reduction in the property taxes. And so I'd just like to make that correction to the staff report.
So that's an annual figure?
Correct. Okay. Yeah. But it should be, I mean, it's, you know, $30 some odd, but 663 rather than 633 estimated loss to the city. With respect to consistency with the general plan, the City of San Carlos's general plan states that the goal is really to protect the San Carlos's historic and cultural resources. To do that, it has adopted a policy which directs the city to promote the maintenance, restoration, and rehabilitation of historic resources through programs such as the Mills Act, which is cited in the general plan. This concludes staff's presentation, and for this item, staff is recommending that the Planning Commission adopt a resolution recommending that the City Council authorize the City Manager to enter into a Millsat contract with the property owner of 40 Pine Avenue in the City of San Carlos. And I'm available for questions if you have any. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Lisa. And the property owner is here as well if the Commission has questions.
Yes, she is.
Oh, great. Okay. Commissioners, do you have questions for Lisa or the property owner at this time? No? Okay, thank you. All right, well, since there's no questions, then any discussion, or would anybody like to make a motion if there's no discussion?
I'll make a motion instead of seconding everything.
Yeah.
I move that the Planning Commission adopt a resolution recommending that the City Council authorize City Manager to enter the Mills Act contract with the property owners of 40 Pine Avenue in the City of San Carlos.
Okay. I'm sorry, Lisa, did you have a comment real quick?
Public hearing, but I believe you have a public comment before you on this item.
Do I? I'm sorry. Did I completely miss that? Walnut. I sure do. Thank you. I'm sorry about that.
I'll take that back, I guess.
Can we just take
it
that back?
It wasn't seconded.
Okay, there we go. Forgive me, I wasn't reading that correctly. I believe we do have a public comment on the item. Kara Vonk? Thank you for that, Lisa.
Thank you. It looks like you're going to vote for it, so I'm not sure my comments might be superfluous. I'm a long-term resident of San Carlos. I'm a founding member of the San Carlos Heritage Association, and I also worked on the 1991 Historic Resource Survey. as a volunteer under the direction of Mr. Kent Seavey, as did many other volunteers. And I urge you to recommend the application for Mills Act agreement, which will help preserve this important San Carlos historic landmark. And it will say something very positive about the city. And I think I'll cut it off at that point. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kara.
I was going to vote no.
Yeah.
But Kara, come on now. Yeah. Thank you very much.
So we're good?
Yeah, I think we're good, Jesse.
All right, let's try that again. I move that Planning Commission adopt a resolution recommending that the City Council authorize the City Manager to enter in a Mills Act contract with the property owner of 40 Pine Avenue in the City of San Carlos.
Can I get a second?
Second.
Great. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, everybody. Yay. And now we're going to move on to our public hearing. And just because there are some new people in the audience, I want to go ahead and read our public hearing procedures thoroughly. Staff is going to present a report on the history, the physical features, et cetera, of the application, followed by staff's recommendation. Then after that, the applicant is going to make a presentation. Thereafter, interested members of the community may come forward to speak on the proposal. And as I mentioned before, just fill out a speaker's card, pass it over to staff, and they will pass it on up to me. After all the members of the public have had the opportunity to be heard, the hearing will be closed and no further discussion from the floor can be held. The commission will then consider the evidence and make its recommendation. If you challenge a public hearing item in court, you may be limited to raising only those issues that either you or someone else raised during public hearing or the public notice or in written correspondence delivered to the city prior to the public hearing. Speakers should fill out the form, and I know many have, and hand it over. That'll help the staff in preparing the minutes. Also, we do ask that you do come up and speak directly into the microphone and address the dais, and then we can go ahead and redirect your questions to staff or to the applicant if you have any questions of them. We also ask that you limit your comments to 3 minutes, and as always, we really appreciate new information, so if you have additional information or additional comments that build on or are different than the previous speaker, we always appreciate that. Okay. Having said that, we are going to address item one on our public hearing agenda, which is 260 Shelford. It is a conditional use permit that was continued from our last meeting to today. However, I believe we are going to continue that to a date uncertain, and I wanted to open that up to staff.
Yes, Chair Harper Pedersen, that is indeed correct. This item was heard at the Planning Commission hearing of October 21st, and at that time, it was determined that the item would be continued to today's date, November 18th, in time for the applicant to come back with additional information that the Planning Commission had requested. Since October 21st, the applicant, Sprint, has reached out to the city and notified that they would like to continue to a date uncertain because they are evaluating other options with respect to their proposal. So at this time, we don't know when Sprint will return to the city with any modifications that they might be contemplating. However, once they do, we will be sure to make sure that the materials included do include the requested information from the Planning Commission that was stated during the October 21st hearing.
Great. And then at this point, we would make a motion to continue to a date uncertain. It would be a move, a motion.
Move.
So the clock stops then, the clock, the 60-day or 90-day clock, does that stop?
I think
that's a good question.
Because they've requested the...
Really quickly, I just want to make sure, after they've discussed, Shannon, if you can restate your question.
I think I was just clarifying what happened with the applicant. The applicant has in writing requested a continuance to an uncertain date. So you don't really need to make a motion. It's basically tabled at this point. And then we'll bring it back at an appropriate time in conformance with federal law.
Great. Shannon had a question.
So there was a timing or a clock that was on this, so that's been halted?
Well, because they have requested it be taken off the calendar, we're in compliance with the act that the applicant has to request the continuance. So.
Great. Okay. Okay. Thank you very much.
One more quick question.
Yeah.
Is the ongoing work that was going on the site by a different entity finished, or is that still continuing today? Do we know?
Would that impact?
I'm just curious. Okay.
Sorry, I just need to clarify. The Mid-Peninsula Water District owns the site and the water tanks on the property, and I know that they are in the process of doing some work to upgrade those tanks, replace those tanks that are currently there. So if there is work being done in and around that area, it could be being done by Mid-Peninsula. That's the only other project that's going on at that site, and I think AT&T's work... I thought they owned both. For that site, 260 Shelford? You know, staff would be, if Mr. Marster, Commissioner Marsters, if you maybe offline, we can have a conversation. Yeah. You can ask about what type of work you're
really
referring
curious.
To. We can look into that to confirm which entity is, in fact, doing the work.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, in that case, if I'm understanding, correct me, and please correct me if I'm wrong, Greg, that this item therefore is tabled and no motion is required. Okay, then we will go ahead and move on to item B, which is 934 Laurel Street, consideration for a request for design review and grading and dirt hall approval, which was continued from the November 4th meeting. And
not November 4th, I don't think. Was it?
Well, we actually continued it from a different meeting, but yes. Great.
Chairman, I just want to make an announcement that this next project is across the street from my office, so I'm going to be recusing myself, and we have a special counsel here tonight, Valerie Armento, who's going to handle this item.
Great. Thank you for letting us know, Greg. And Lisa, will you be presenting on 934? Great. Thank you.
All right. Good evening once again. This item is for a proposed new structure located at 934 Laurel Street. And as you recall, this item was first presented to the Planning Commission on August 5th. And it was continued to a date uncertain, pending potential modifications and requests for information that the Planning Commission had asked for. It was scheduled to be on the November 4th Planning Commission agenda. However, there was a computer-generated error in the addressing in the address list of the mailing distribution list. And as a necessity, we need to have a duly publicly noticed hearing. We continue the item to tonight. So the application, again, to refresh everyone's memory, is for design review to approve the structure and on-site landscaping, as well as an associated grading and dirt hall permit to remove more than 1,000 cubic yards. As the commission might recall, anything more than 1,000 cubic yards would require planning commission approval. The location of this site is on the west side of Laurel Street. It's a 5,842 square foot vacant lot between Arroyo Avenue and Morse Boulevard. The general plan land use designation for this property, and in fact all the properties along Laurel Street from Arroyo down to Eaton, is mixed use low density, and the accompanying zoning district is MUN neighborhood mixed use. And I wanted to provide the commission with a little bit of context in terms of the zoning designation. I just showed a portion of Laurel Street in this nice Google map here, but on the zoning map, the project is located maybe just where this P is located, and hopefully if we can all see this color correctly, it's a fuchsia color, bright pink, all the way from Arroyo on the same side of Laurel down to the municipal limit line, with a shared limit line with Redwood City. And you can also find MUN in other areas of the city along Old County Road and on one side on the, I guess, the south side of this is San Carlos Avenue here. And there's also a bit of MUN over in this part of El Camino Real. And one of the things you might notice is that the MUN zoning district really provides a transition in the sense of by being its own unique zoning designation from the more commercial-oriented zoning districts here, so that you don't have more intense development right up against residential districts here that are shown in yellow. This is intended to have the same character of the commercial areas and permitted uses in this zone, but it has additional development standards in play that help provide a transition from commercial to residential, and we'll talk about that just in a minute as well. If you have any questions on this, we can certainly come back to it. The project description, as you recall, is for a three-story mixed-use building. Mixed-use meaning that there are two ground-floor commercial spaces. There's two spaces. One is just over 1,000 square feet. The other is about 1,200, just over 1,200 square feet. And then there are three apartments above, two on the second story and one on the third story. During the August 5th Planning Commission hearing, there were several concerns noted by the neighbors that expressed their concerns in public testimony to the commission as well as in written testimony. And there were some concerns and requests also from the Planning Commission. Altogether, these amounted to concerns about the reduction in privacy and perhaps the project being able to be too visible or having too many views into neighboring backyards to the rear of the site. The other concern had to do with parking overflow into the residential neighborhood and on-site drainage and flooding, how the proposed undergrounding parking might affect that. There was also some requests to look into the dirt haul route to see if it was possible to remove Holly Street from that proposed dirt haul route, as it was noted in the certificate. The other comment had to do with bicycle parking. It was stated that there should, you know, be an attempt to provide more bicycle parking, especially in the front of the site next to those commercial spaces that are proposed. So with the applicant has proposed in response to those concerns is to add additional screening to address views and privacy to the adjacent residences. To do that, they've proposed inserting a permanent planter box, if you will, around the inset of the third-story balcony. And they're proposing to landscape that with a hedge that would grow about 2 feet taller than the top of that balcony wall. They've also proposed adding in, and this should be in the plans, the 13 additional 36-inch box-size Italian cypress trees at the corner opposite of the location of the cork oak, so to fill in the gap where there were concerns about visibility. They also provided some statements from their engineer addressing drainage with respect to how that would be affected by the underground parking. City staff had worked with Public Works to get those engineer statements peer-reviewed, and all of that documentation is in your staff report. And essentially, as a result of the peer review, it concluded that there would be little to no effect on surface flows or surface flooding as a result of this project. Staff also consulted with Public Works staff to see if it's possible to remove Holly Street from the dirt haul route. It was. The dirt haul route has been changed. In addition, there are three new at-grade bike racks located in the northwest corner of the front of the property. Those should be noted on your plans as well. And then there was also concern about pedestrians walking on Laurel Street and interfacing with the driveway leading to the underground parking. The applicant is proposing cautionary signage located in the landscaped areas on both sides of that driveway. So in both directions, pedestrians would be able to see some cautionary signage that there is a driveway where cars might be exiting out of, entering to, or exiting out of. Staff went through and provided some additional information with respect to consistency analysis for determining consistency with the general plan, with the zoning, and with the design review criteria. As you might recall, these were noted discussion items at the last hearing. Based upon information policies in the general plan and the requirements of the zoning ordinance that actually call for greater standards and more restrictive standards for height, overall height of a project, as well as rear yard setbacks. Touching upon that, for example, if you are in the MUN zoning district and you're located within a certain distance of a residential zoning district, an RS district, then the height limit of 50 feet that would have otherwise been allowed is dropped down by 20 feet to 30 feet. So that's an example of one of the more restrictive standards just in terms of context and location by being next to a residential zoning district. In addition, staff wanted to touch upon the design review criteria about projects being compatible with neighboring development and avoiding big differences in scale. Something worth noting in staff's recommendation is that being compatible doesn't mean being the same. Two things can be different but still be able to work together. And because this is a project that was originally proposed at four stories, went down to three, with a third story being minimized in both being pushed back or stepped back from both the front and rear elevations, it's doing a good job at attempting to be workable within the neighborhood, and staff didn't find that to be a big difference in overall building scale. The required findings that the Planning Commission would make with respect to approving this project is to approve that it is indeed consistent with the standards in the zoning ordinance. Staff went through and did a thorough analysis. The project does comply with all of the requirements of the zoning ordinance. It's consistent with the general plan, many different policies, that it be sensitive to adjacent structures, and it is providing that transition, which is reflected in the zoning ordinance. It also is including two commercial uses, which is consistent with general plan LU58, which encourages retail uses along Laurel Street to support economic vitality and support surrounding uses. There's many different general plan policies that this project would be consistent with. The other finding is that the proposed grading would not adversely affect the drainage or lateral support of other properties in the area, based upon the information as it was reviewed by the engineers and reviewed by Public Works. This finding can also be made. So before I state staff's recommendation, I would just like to conclude that Jill and I are available for any questions the Planning Commission may have. I know that the applicant has prepared additional information for the Planning Commission to really provide a close-up view and some graphical information about how those views may be affected with respect to the additional landscaping that's being proposed. The recommendation by staff before you is to approve design review to allow the construction of this new mixed-use building consisting of the three new apartments above two ground floor commercial spaces and the associated grading and dirt hall permit to remove 1,327 cubic yards of earth at 934 Laurel. And I will go ahead and minimize this. I can bring up the formal motions if and when the commission is ready so that I can allow the applicant to queue up their presentation.
Great.
Otherwise, staff is available for questions. Thank you.
Thank you. I think maybe at this point we hear from the applicant and then ask questions, unless you have quick questions for Lisa.
What I would like to do is to declare ex parte communication. And so I actually met with the developer on September 3rd to discuss changes to the project that they were considering.
Great. Does anybody else have any ex parte communications to disclose? None. Thank you, Scott. Would the applicant like to make a presentation?
Good evening. My name is Benjamin McGriff, the architect representing Michael Parabody, the developer and client for this project. Like Lisa said, primarily what you'll see in this presentation is a visual representation of how we addressed some of those concerns, in particular the line of sight privacy issues. This first slide is really a kind of a summary, not dissimilar to what Lisa earlier discussed. We broke it down into the four categories of privacy concerns: parking concerns, drainage concerns, and then miscellaneous. Both the parking and drainage, I think, have been handled by the city as well as our engineer statements. And then the miscellaneous concerns sort of wrap up some minor details like overflow of lighting and dirt haul routes, both of which I think are built into city requirements that we will be addressing. The privacy concerns in particular are being addressed on a couple of levels. First off, we wanted to talk a little bit further about the existing vegetation on the site and the relative scale. Again, you can see the existing site with the adjacent.
Can we do one thing?
Sure, sure.
I'm just going to make it a little bigger.
That's reasonable.
There we go. Okay.
Thanks. So here's our existing site, 934 Laurel. Here's across the street with the multi-story commercial and mixed-use structures. This is a sort of an existing vegetation slide. You can see the large cork oak tree in the back, which I believe at the end of the last hearing, one of the commissioners asked if it was deciduous. It is in fact not deciduous. It keeps its leaves year-round. You have some existing Italian cypress here that are very mature. A few other unidentified pieces of vegetation, trees. This is to the northeast corner. This is the southeast corner, southeast corner, again from the back of the site looking across the street. And this is looking towards the southwest corner where you can see, again, some existing trees, some Italian cypress off in the distance. Working within that, the idea was, again, as Lisa pointed out, how do we really address this one vacant or exposed corner of the property, since this one is already very, very well matured, covered by matured growth. In lieu of building some scaffolding out there such that everybody could see for themselves what the view was from 30 feet, we developed this a 3D rendering that was our attempt to accurately, as best we could, represent not just the existing conditions, but the impact of these proposed alterations to the landscape. So you can see as we move from the previous slide back to this one. Let's see. So again, it's not perfect, but it's pretty close. I think the cork oak tree, for example, is even larger than what we're using. So again, this is the site with the footprint of the building. You can see the canopy of the cork oak tree to the southeast corner. In the shadow here are the Italian cypresses on the northern property. These are the existing trees to the southwest corner. You can start to see some of these Italian cypress over on this property line as well. This was the previously proposed planting plan that was presented at the last hearing. This illustrates a new location for the 36 inch box Italian cypress. We consulted with our landscape architect, Paul Blanchfield, who's here tonight, if you have any questions, of the largest size of initial planted Italian cypress could be found. And 11 to 12 feet is approximately is what's typically found. And so that's what we're proposing here. The next question was, how fast will they grow? Obviously, we love to plant 30-foot Italian cypress that are like the ones that are existing, but it's just not feasible. So within a five-year period and reasonable maintenance, it was projected that it could grow 1 to 2 feet each year, which would put us at 22 feet. So
So the slide just before that was what they would be when you install.
That's day one planting.
Got it. Okay.
This is 5 years from now.
Got it. Thank you.
Or 5 years from planting date.
Okay.
So then from there, we wanted to talk about how that actually affected the site. So I kind of got washed out here, but this slide is talking about the cone of vision that was previously available at the last hearing. You can kind of see the pink. The pink is sort of triangulates down from somebody standing at the rear of the terrace that was raised as a concern, and then another one from an individual standing at what would essentially be the bedroom on the rear second floor unit. Again, you kind of, these are the visibility that was expressed by some of the neighbors at the last hearing. And so with the planting of the Italian cypress here, again, a little bit washed out, but you can see that from the second floor, it's completely cutting off your vision aside from over the existing buildings. Off in the distance, this is the Italian cypress that I mentioned on the rear neighboring properties, and that's your two-story building at 929. This little mocked-up smaller one is approximately the residence at 925. This is a little shed at the rear of their property. And those are the properties to the southwest corner that are in question. So this is from, again, this slide. This is essentially the perspective on day one of the planting of the Italian cypress. This is at year five. Then the next slide is, this was the previously presented elevational renderings. And then with the addition of, it's kind of subtle here and small, but you can see this, the contiguous planter box, elevated planter box, such that the dirt is at the same height as the top of the railing or parapet here. This is the addition of at least 2 foot tall contiguous shrub. Again, sort of, you can see it pop up there. Okay, then this is the perspective from that top rear terrace again. And with the planting height being at the 42-inch rail height, which is, you know, to code, 2 feet on top of that, again, completely obstructs your view. And as I understand it, the health and maintenance of this is attached to the approval of the building. So I know there are some neighbors that are expressing concern that they could simply just not water it and this wouldn't actually do its job. But as I understand it, that's not the case. It is, in fact, required to be maintained.
Repeat that, because I can't hear you that
well. Sure, sorry. I believe there's some concern that with this solution, that if the plants weren't watered, then it was no longer a solution.
Right.
And it's my understanding that this would be attached as a condition of approval. The health and welfare of these plants would be attached to the condition of approval for this project. So, in effect, it would be required to be maintained.
Is this a shrub selected already?
Currently we're proposing rosemary in keeping with, again, the sort of Mediterranean okay. revival aesthetic, which sort of goes along with the Italian cypress as well. But if that's not amenable, we're open to suggestion.
Great. Thank you.
Let's see. And then this final slide here addresses something that we kind of glossed over the first time around. It was really the change in scale and modifications made since the beginning of this project. Our initial submittal for preliminary application review was May of 2012. You can see the four-story structure here. I know that there was a misconception at the last hearing that what we currently have designed is, in fact, was maxing out what's allowed for this zoning. This was, in fact, what was allowed for the zoning. And so we applied for the preliminary application review. I think we had some traffic studies to verify that our parking configuration confirmed, and a few other steps were made. We performed a neighborhood outreach meeting a year ago, I think next week. The two primary concerns that addressed that hearing were the building was one story too tall, and they wanted to make sure that the this oak in the back was health was maintained. We took this information back to our clients, and at the end of the day, we understood that it was important to the community that we that this did fit in scale-wise, and we thought that the concession of giving up a full floor, as well as carving out some of this remaining third floor, would help and addressing some of these concerns and build some goodwill. I can't really see in the back. This is the recessed third floor in the front elevation. One issue that may not be apparent, with a parcel of this size, in order for an investment property to work at this scale with a typical 50-foot wide lot as we have here, this third floor is what makes this project feasible. Without it's a non-starter. And then, of course, there are the changes that have been made via the landscaping today. And if there's any other questions about the design that we went over first time around, obviously I'd be happy to address them as well.
I do have just one quick question. I understand that there were some have there been any agreements or anything resolved with individual neighbors since we spoke since we heard you at the last hearing?
There have not.
Okay. Thank you. Does anybody else have any questions for the applicant at this time before we hear the public?
How tall were the cypress trees going to grow? I didn't quite hear that.
The projected growth rate, correct me if I'm wrong, Paula, was 1 to 2 feet per year. Mm-hmm. I think the healthy growth is a 10-foot growth over 5 years is pretty safe to assume. So we were showing them at 22 feet tall. Okay. And, of course, they would keep maturing, much like the ones around the property. Okay.
Do you have any questions of the applicant before we hear from the public?
No. Wait, no, just to confirm, you said there's been no additional outreach?
Not since the last hearing. No, we with the summarization at the end of the last hearing, as the commission summarized what they heard, we chose to take that as our direction for how to focus our presentation.
Okay.
Great. Thank you. All right. Well, at this time, then, I'd like to go ahead and open it up to public comment. And I have everybody's speaker cards in order that I received them. Again, a reminder just to speak as clearly as you can into the microphone. We do ask that you limit to 3 minutes, and the new information is always appreciated by the dais. Our first speaker is Romanita Redulescu. Did I mess up your last name? Thank you. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everybody. I have to say that I'm not a good speaker, so please be patient with me. Luckily, it's very short. We are owners and residents of 939 Laurel Street. It's also a mixed use, and we are on the second floor. And I noticed in the material on the table there that there were 54 people who signed the petition against the height and the other issues for this proposed building. And I would like to, I mean, these are mainly the people from behind the building. We live on Laurel, so I would like to add at this time at least 5 adults. We were not aware of the petition that was filed in February, so obviously the Walnut residents organized themselves much better. So we have the same concerns as they stated, so I will just go over them quickly. We believe that the building is not architecturally and aesthetically blending into the prior buildings over there, and I have to disagree with what your staff presented. You have seasoned buildings over there. Majority of them in that block, 900 block of Laurel, are one-story older houses, 60 years old or more, and they are actually some small houses which are two stories, but the stories are really low. In regards of the height of the building, as the architect presented here today, section the drawing is A40. It's basically not a three-story, but it's a three-story, 1, 2, 3, and a half, because the commercial space is actually 1 story and a half. The commercial space is higher. So we were we lived there for 14 years since December 99, and we were welcoming something being built there. It didn't look good like that, but we don't understand why such a big building is developed. Also, the architect presented today. So this was the the section, but he's presented the plan, and you, as you could see, the building basically takes almost the whole lot. Mm-hmm. So on the sides, you basically cannot do the robust landscaping that they're talking about. So, especially on the right side where people go into the building. So we are concerned about parking because Laurel Street is very crowded, and we are concerned about traffic that the people on Walnut Street didn't mention, so that would be an additional thing. I was at the prior council meeting, and I know that the council people are worried about traffic in San Carlos. When it's busy, we have a long line of cars waiting for the stop sign at Laurel and Arroyo. So it's going to have cars coming on a ramp to go into traffic. It's going to be a problem, I think. And we are also concerned about the resale value of our condos at 939 Laurel Street. And also we're concerned that something that the Walnut people didn't mention. We're concerned about the noise. So if you compute two commercial units, who knows what the destination is going to be, the use, plus three residential, you have five. If you say at least two, three cars per unit, you get maybe 15 cars a day that move around, you know, adding to traffic and the noise. Yes, and so I believe that this building as it is with 3.5 stories is towering the other constructions around it. I believe it's not a good choice for the developer to do. And I was present a year ago at the first meeting at Starbucks on Laurel, and after that I was out of the country in August, so I wasn't able to participate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Great. Next I have Jennifer Kelly.
Good evening, Chairperson and Commissioners. I represent 925 Walnut. And as the Commission might recall from the August 5th meeting, the use of the commercial space was as yet undetermined, and I was wondering if it's since been determined?
That's a question for the applicant. I do not think so.
One of the commissioners asked it. Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much.
The reason I bring it up is the unspecified use of the commercial space raises the concern for possibility that it might be used as a food and beverage establishment. An eatery of any kind, including maybe just a coffee shop, although there are plenty of those, would impose on the neighborhood the noise of vendor deliveries, which are typically early, the noise of employees closing and taking out trash, et cetera, which is typically later hours, the odor of food-based garbage, as eateries always have in those areas of the property that they use, and the unavoidable vermin that is attracted in those scenarios. I'm requesting that the commission would exclude food and beverage-based use in any commercial structure that would be built on this proposed lot, as well as the entire block in the future. Regarding the specific structure for this lot, I just wanted to bring up one more point about the noise that was just brought up. On the neighborhood on Walnut Street, if there was one residential home built on that lot, this empty lot, there would be the living noise of one household. We are now going to incur the living noise of three households and two commercial entities. That's a lot. I love the idea of the landscaping that's been proposed for some of the issues of privacy and just the looming feeling. With regards to the oak tree, I'd like to know what guarantees would be put in place if the oak tree was indeed damaged, which is going to be, I understand, protected during the building process in the underground garage if it's approved. But what if? What is the guarantee? The solution with regards to the other living green solutions, again, what would be the guarantee of maintenance that's required by whomever is utilizing that space? Parking, that's pretty much a standard. In the absence of a new parking solution downtown, it's just kind of crazy overall. And the only other part I was going to address is the size. Our neighborhood has been talking about the objection to the height. And the first size was just too big. It took up too much of the lot. And we understand now that the size has been reduced. Unfortunately, it fails to meet the design review criterion for the harmonious transition in scale. In character, unfortunately, I disagree a little bit with my neighbor. I find the structure has beauty and charm that benefits the community. I understand that that block is going to evolve into the multi-use eventually. It's going to be fully multi-use. That's an aesthetic I'd like to see. Unfortunately, the scale of the structure fails to meet the harmonious transition criterion, so much so that the structure is clearly demonstrating that the quantitative restrictions themselves fail the spirit of that harmonious transition criterion, and those requirements might, in fact, in and of themselves, need to be changed accordingly for future of that whole block. The scale of the proposed structure has been an issue for the entire residential neighborhood surrounding it, imposing significant decreases in the quality of living in those spaces, as cried out by many of the neighbors on August 5th and today. Of course, the obvious argument in disparity is the height, three stories going down to the single-story, predominantly to single-story neighborhood. The big factor in the size, though, is the overall scale. We can't just look at height from three down to one. Scale isn't just height, it's overall size in space. So the single-story homes that dominate this area are small in scale. They're not just single-story, they're little. They have a small footprint, and the scale to scale is not harmonious, not just the decrease in height. If the homes were of a larger square footage footprint, the transition would probably seem more harmonious, even though they're single story, from the three stories down to the one story. The fact is the homes that dominate this area are single storied and small in overall scale, and the proposed structure fills up a lot of its lot, even though it's shrunk in its redesign. It renders the proposed structure still looming in the neighborhood. Looming is inharmonious. Sticking out like a sore thumb is inharmonious. If the proposed building were two stories and the same length and the same width, then the scale would be far less inharmonious and more fitting to the spirit of the design review code. So as such, regarding size, I would be in complete agreement for this structure to be built in its current style if the second floor was removed and the third dropped down. I understand from what I heard that this may not be a starter if that was the case. The ROI, I guess, would just not be there for them. But this is where we're living, and this is what we have to live with. So if we could take that second floor out and just drop the third floor down, it would be fantastic for me. Should the commission approve the structure as a three-story one, it might end up being a little bit of a planning failure where people drive by and go, who approved that? You know, it might be one of those scenarios. So I thank you for listening and hopefully for hearing, and I implore you to ensure and protect and administer the design review's harmonious transition spirit and wisdom of scale.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. Thank you. And I have a note from Michael Kelly. Did Michael have to leave? Oh, are you here? Would you like to come on up? Thank you.
Good evening, commissioners. I also represent 925. However, I was asked to speak on behalf of two of the neighbors who, unfortunately, with the reschedule of the November 4th hearing, since they're out of town and traveling, to read their letters. The first is from Larry Vanderveen and his wife Inez Colombetti, who reside at 929 Walnut Street. Planning Commission members, as part of the neighborhood that will be negatively impacted by the proposed construction at 934 Laurel Street, we, Larry Vanderveen and Inez Colombetti, continue our opposition to the proposal plan. We will not be in attendance at tonight's meeting, but we want our voices heard. As a result of the August 5th, 2013 Planning Commission meeting for the same topic, the Commission, after listening to vociferous objection from many neighbors, a final decision to deny the building plan was postponed. At that time, some board members had significant concerns, as echoed by the neighborhood, regarding whether the plan met the intent of building policy LU-819 and LU-811, as well as three issues summarized here as intrusive size of the building, flooding and parking. The board has also added issues of bicycle parking and dirt hall route, which was already addressed. By far, the most significant issue is the size of the obtrusiveness of the proposed building. Its sheer size is in direct conflict with LU-819 and LU-811. It completely blocks and dwarfs the single-story housing directly adjacent to the vacant lot. It allows unrestricted sight lines across the back fence, although, again, some of the changes were certainly appreciative. As the owner of 925, we're the one that's completely exposed to the new property in question. The builder, in seeming disregard for the merit of the neighborhood concerns, answered by offering place movable planters and hedges on the third-story rear deck to eliminate the obstructive view. The difficulty with proposal is twofold. Planter boxes can be moved, and residences of the property can choose not to maintain the hedges or also move the planters. Hence, the issue remains resolved. The parking and flooding impact remains unaddressed in general as well. Larry Vanderveen and his wife, Inez Colombetti, encouraged the board members to disprove the plan at this evening's event. There was clearly insufficient consideration given by the builder to make this project more suitable for the neighborhood, and our opinion for the conversation will not resolve our differences. That is from the Vanderveens.
Yeah, and I also want to mention that the Vanderdeens did submit the letter in writing, and we do appreciate that as well. So okay. We have it for the record.
There you go. Then I have just one other brief statement as well, and this is from Marge Boots, 920 Walnut Street.
We have that one, too.
You do have that
one? Yeah, it's an email dated Sunday, November 17th.
Okay, that is correct.
Is that the same one?
That is the same one. So obviously, for sake of time, if you obviously can duly note that the arguments there for the for Marge Boots would also be recognized by the commission.
Correct. Thank you. And, yeah, we definitely do have it, and we really appreciate the written comments, and they're all submitted in the record.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. And now I have Dobrere. Did I say that correctly? From 917 Walnut? Okay, well, I'll make a note for the record that he is in opposition of the project. Great, thank you. Next is Robert Hatton. I apologize, Robert. I should read my notes. Next is Margaret Pye. Yeah, it's
SC
right on there.
Sorry. Hi, Margaret Pye, 926 Laurel Street, right next door to this property. You can imagine how I feel about this. I've already spoken before. Much to my surprise, the staff report didn't mention my comments at the August meeting. They only said people from Walnut Street showed up, but the minutes showed that I was here, so I was definitely here in August. I definitely opposed it in August, so I'd like that to be noted. This building is going to be about 6 feet from my property line, obstructing my windows, views, sunlight forever. So I am not happy about it. I agree with all the comments the other people made. The abrupt change of height from my very small one-story house to the three-story building next door is not what you would call a smooth transition. So I wish they could do something.
Margaret, may I ask a quick question?
Sure.
Has there been any additional conversation between you and the developer to mitigate light concern? Okay,
no.
I just wanted to make sure and note that for the record.
No,
Thank you.
No, we specifically asked for some concessions, and we were told no.
Okay. Thank you very much for letting me know that. Great. I'm going to ask you to respond as soon as to a couple of these as soon as I'm done with our public comment. But yes, and don't let me forget you. The last speaker card I have on 7B is from Jean Diggle. Okay. And then, yes, I'll definitely let you come up and respond. And I apologize for not doing that last time.
So my name is Jean Diggle. I'm here to speak for my husband and myself. We live on the west-facing side of Walnut Street, almost opposite where this property is going in. When they sent around their original letter, I remember very well, I opened up the letter, and the first thing it said, that they were going to develop this empty lot. And, just looking at the letter, I was like, thank heavens, they're putting something in. It's not going to be. And then the very next page was this behemoth, and, of course, it's the four-story version. Within a week, it had disappeared like it never existed and been replaced with the three-story. They must have had it ready. I can only assume that they knew that the four-story one was not going to be popular. We tried. They did have some meetings at Starbucks. My husband and Adam Dober tried to go down. They left more than an hour before they said they were going to be there. We were never able to speak with them. And so their public outreach didn't actually reach us. Otherwise, I guess the only thing that's different that I would like to say than my neighbors have said is that I'm extremely uneasy about the fact that all of their concessions to privacy involve living things that have finite lifetimes. I don't know about my neighbors, but I firmly intend to outlive that oak tree on Walnut Street, and you're not going to replace that easily when it goes, right? So I really wish that they would consider some options that didn't have all of the lovely outdoor space for their apartments flush up facing out into our block and in our yards and in our street.
Great.
Otherwise, I don't have anything too new to say.
Thank you very much, Jane. Thank you, everybody, for your public comments. I really appreciate it. And I would like to invite the applicant back to respond to some of the public comment concerns. First, since it is one of the more recent ones, I had asked if you'd had any additional conversations with neighbors about mitigation.
And there was a correspondence, but that was prior to our previous hearing.
I see.
Which is why I answered.
Okay. So has there been a resolution between
the
property?
The item I wanted to clarify was that we did. It's been a long time since between when we actually had our initial outreach to the time of the first hearing, so I know the details can get fuzzy. You're actually in the binders you originally received. You have copies of correspondence from all of the primary members here tonight that have been speaking for the most part, in particular the last two speakers. What was the original offer to the Pies was to install a skylight in their kitchen to make up for the loss of daylight.
Okay, so that was proposed.
Right, okay. And the reason that was that ultimately was revoked was that there was a kind of a counter offer for, instead of skylight, replace all the windows and doors that faced that side of the property, amongst a few other things that raised concerns with counsel for our client. Of entering into a contract that would tie us to repairing the building and years from now for problems that might not be related to this project. So it was decided at that time that any sort of construction on the neighbor's property wasn't advisable. In regards to I'm sorry, the neighbors across the street, the previous speaker, mm-hmm. last speaker, we did in fact miss them at Starbucks at our original outreach meeting. What happened there was, in our letter to the neighbors notifying them of the meeting, we requested they'd select time slots to speak with us because it's hard to talk to everybody at once. After, I believe it was probably an hour before our available window that we had identified to speak with neighbors, everybody had left. We thought that was it. We did follow up with those neighbors, as you will actually have in your binders, with the same information that we presented at that initial outreach hearing. We do regret missing them initially, but I think there was some correspondence that will show that we did. There was outreach.
Just one additional question.
Sure.
For the correspondence between you and the Pies.
Sure.
So a skylight was proposed, but it was countered by the Pies with all windows and doors, and your council advised against
for one
that.
Side of the building. Well, it was just one piece of the request. In addition.
I see.
And some of it was just some very basic, and they're all very reasonable questions. And from obviously being being a homeowner and not ever having a project built next to them like this, there was a number of concerns that just simply needed to be addressed with noise and dust control and that sort of thing.
Right.
But there was a few other guarantees requested that exceeded what the counsel for our client felt was reasonable to agree to.
Okay.
For a neighboring property. And
so then,
thus it changed the nature of what we were trying to do as an olive branch to something more of a contractual relationship that
I see.
We were reticent to enter into.
There
was some follow-up correspondence after that that involved we'd promised that we would help our office offer our proposed design for green screening between our the proposed property and their property and locations of trees. And there's follow-up correspondence to that regard. I can't recall what else, but I do recall that was part of it.
Okay. Yeah. So at this time, then, only some correspondence around the green screening has been essentially agreed to between
There was definitely more than that. There was concerns about exhaust from the garage, that sort of thing down below, which, you know, by code you have to get it up through the roof,
right.
Things like that. Some other, there, I guess, more specific.
So some
things.
Technical questions that were answered. Okay.
Yeah, the ones that we could answer at the time.
Okay, yeah. But the light issue was never resolved.
Right, because that involved construction on the property.
Okay. Thank you for answering my questions. Sure. Does anybody else have any follow-up questions for the applicant based on the public comment?
Not yet?
Okay. In that case, we're not going to hear any more.
I want to ask staff a couple of questions.
Staff some questions. Okay.
The first one is about the idea of a restaurant. And are restaurants allowed in that commercial space there? And if so, do they need a conditional use permit?
Yes, Commissioner Marsters. In the MUN zoning district, restaurants would require a use permit. It would either go to the zoning administrator or to the planning commission, depending upon the number of chairs, but it overall does require a use permit.
And I guess a follow-up question then would be, is that in our, I know a resident had mentioned requesting to exclude food beverage-based use. I'm not suggesting that we would be in favor of that. I was just curious if that is something we could or could not do legally. I'm not trying to tie you guys one way or another. I just want to know if it's a possibility.
So this is a conditional. A restaurant would be only allowed as a conditional use. So it's not something that's as of right. So right. It would be something that you would be evaluating if it came forward. So it's rather difficult to say that you're eliminating something that's conditional to begin with, that's not automatic.
Okay. That makes sense. Thank you.
The question that I would ask is, can we make it a conditional use permit for this particular building so that it would require coming back to the Planning Commission rather than a zoning
staff
administrator?
Just to clarify, it is currently required to go through a use permit process for consideration. So it's already built into the land use regulations for this zoning district.
But is it a zoning administrator
comes to the commission,
or is it a conditional use that actually comes back to the Planning Commission?
At 12 chairs or less, it's zoning administrator, and anything more than 12 chairs goes up to the Planning Commission. And of course, even the zoning administrator could kick it up to the Planning Commission.
And is the 12 chairs both inside and outside?
It's just total.
Total chairs.
Yeah.
Okay. Next question I have is the landscaping on the balcony, a potential hedge. Is that currently included as part of the project, and that landscaping will be maintained for the life of the project, as well as all the landscaping on the property?
Commissioner Marsters, that's correct. Any landscaping that's proposed as part of this site plan that is up for consideration by the Planning Commission, if approved, would be required to be maintained in perpetuity.
So how do they deal with the oak tree? Say, as part of the project, the oak tree dies. What happens?
You could add that in as a condition of approval, but because it's part of the proposed landscape plan, it is existing, but it's part of their overall proposal for site landscaping, it would require
to be maintained in perpetuity. So for any landscaping, plants, trees, or whatnot that may fall to disease or for some other reason not be able to survive, it would be incumbent upon the property owner to maintain the plantings as they've been proposed in that original landscaping plan.
So it's already a part of our conditions of approval, but then what, and I'm sorry, Scott, if I'm jumping in, but what might the recourse be if it, like, for example, if something does happen and they don't maintain it, what would the city ordinarily do as recourse for that situation?
It would be referred to a matter of code enforcement.
I see. Thank you.
Would they be required to plant, like, a 24-inch box oak tree? Or
I should clarify that we would reach out with the property owner and require, you know, to let them know that, you know, there is a landscape plan that was approved. You know, please provide the replacement tree. If that wasn't done over, you know, a reasonable amount of time, it would then become a matter of code enforcement.
I'm getting there.
And as a suggestion, we're discussing over here, because the cork oak tree is a significant component of the landscape plan, that's what I'm hearing, the commission could add in a condition of approval to require a replacement tree be planted in that location, you know, that screens the area that's of a significant size, maybe 24 or 48-inch box size replacement tree, should something happen to that cork oak tree.
That was my concern. A 24, 48-inch box tree is not going to be very significant in relationship to the size of the existing oak. So they're planting 13 or cypress that are all 24-inch box trees, and it's going to be 5 years before those get to the height that is really reflective of where they're going to block.
That's a pretty fast-growing tree.
Through the chair, one other thing that I might add to this conversation, the landscape architect for the project is here tonight, so it might be helpful to continue this conversation, maybe asking what other kind of plantings or tree types that might be acceptable to the commission that are fast-growing could be planted in that area.
Scott, would you like to hear from the landscape architect?
Love to hear from the landscape.
Could you come up and address the commissioner's concern? Fast-growing giant trees. That's what we want.
My name is Paul Blanchfield. Ransohoff Blanchfield Jones is my office. There are any number of fairly fast-growing oaks. I mean, even the cork oak replaced with a 48-inch box cork oak would grow much more quickly than the traditional California live oak that we see that grows very slowly.
Okay.
You could use some of the, which I wouldn't really recommend, but you could use some of the acacias and some of the Australian trees. That would not be my first choice. I would rather go back with one or two oaks that would get to be fairly sizable. The East Coast Virginiana oak is also evergreen. I would definitely would like to see something like that go back in. And they grow fairly quickly.
Okay.
It is not an impossible task to bring in trees that would, over a relatively short time for a very long live tree, turn into a useful screening product.
Okay. Scott, do you have any follow-up questions for
landscape? Actually, I have one more concerning trees, and that is the potential to plant the trees in the back prior to construction.
On the left-hand side where the Italian cypress are proposed, they are in an area that is going to be not over any structures or anything like that, so they will grow very well. However, there's going to have to be over-excavating for the engineering portion of building the walls. So I think that they probably couldn't go in ahead of time because there's a 5 or 6 foot area, and some of that will be challenged during construction.
You mean on the left side, not on the back?
I'm talking in the back.
Okay, but if...
As you face the building,
yeah,
on the left side, we have a little more room there, and there's going to be real dirt.
The garage, but the garage is not going any further back than the building itself,
correct.
Right? So the garage is actually underneath. And that's underneath the ground.
If you look at the planting plan, there's a perimeter hedge. Everything else that is in there before, I've put some mounding in so that we could have a little more soil. And I've put a little sitting area so that the people who live in the place can actually go outside. And those spaces are over the garage and are, have limited root space for growing tall trees.
So once the foundation is in place, can the trees be planted at that point rather than waiting until the entire building is constructed? I'm trying to get the maximum amount of growth in place prior to
the building.
I don't see. I can't say that on this date at this point it'll be possible, but it's definitely possible to go in ahead of the rest of the building and the interior finishing, and you know, there's a lot of time between when the foundation goes in and the rest of the building is complete.
That's what I'm getting, a head start on
the growing of plants, especially they're going in at 36 inch box size, which is pretty substantial for an Italian cypress. And most of us see them put in at 15 gallon or something, and they grow pretty fast. So we're trying to head that off to begin with.
So potentially then, as a condition, we can just ask that the landscaping be put in as soon as feasible?
Once framing starts or something? I mean, when something...
Any other questions for the landscape architect at this point?
Not for the landscape architect.
Okay. I just wanted to note that we did not close public comment, so I have received another speaker card. I apologize. But I would love to hear from Jean again, so please come on
before up. Before she comes up, I probably wouldn't ask this question other than I'm just curious, and someone made a comment. Do we know how old that cork oak is, and do we have a time estimate as far as the age of the cork oak?
My bet is that it is from the early 1900s.
And
1925 maybe, somewhere. My guess is it was planted when the house that was there before was built, because it is not indigenous to the area. It wouldn't have just been around. You know, it's not like some of the live oaks that are definitely a couple of hundred years old, but it goes back to whenever the previous house was built. That was probably part of the landscaping.
And what's the lifespan of a cork oak?
It's long. And there will be me, probably an arborist, I am sure, because I beat up my contractors a little bit to make sure those trees survive. It's really important that they survive.
Is it a 100-year tree?
A couple hundred years, 300 years, 400 years?
It's a big, healthy tree. There's a real good chance that it's going to live another 100 years. The nice part about it is that it is in the adjacent properties as well. The root systems are running to the poor people that live right behind it and to the people on the other side of it.
There was some reaction back there. It sounds like the roots are probably
You know, the roots are everywhere, and there's only maybe a quarter of the roots in this yard. So there are substantial roots elsewhere, and maybe you can get everybody else to promise that they won't do anything nasty under the trees also, because that's really a possibility.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Any other questions for the landscape architect or arborist before I let her? Okay, Jean, please come on up. We'd love to hear what you have to say.
I apologize for this, but my husband specifically asked me to mention this, and it just went right out my head when I was up before. But we are also concerned about the precedent this sets for the rest of the block.
Sure.
You only have to walk down some of the streets that have gone mixed use to see what the little houses surrounded by rows of bigger buildings look like. And it's not hard to imagine over time that that's going to fill in all the way down. And, you know, the bigger this one is, you know, the more all the rest of them are going to be similarly sized to match. Thanks.
That's a good point. Thank you, Gene, for coming back up.
I'd like to move to close the public hearing.
Great. Okay. No, it's okay, Gene. I think that's an excellent point. Thank you for coming back up. And can I get a second to close the public hearing?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. So then at this point, are there any additional questions for staff or questions based on what we've heard?
Yes.
Okay.
So
not testimony questions.
Let's see.
let's get that straight.
Policy LU 8.19 talks about avoiding interference with the right or ability to use solar energy, and I was just curious what impact this has on the house to the north as far as solar energy.
Just to the house to the north?
That's
Thank
the
you
only
for
one
allowing
really
us to confirm. This policy would only have an effect, potential effect, if there were solar panels already there on those residences that you're referring to.
But it says the right or ability to use solar energy. So you would still have the ability to use it even if you didn't have solar panels at the moment. Okay, by putting a building up that's too tall, you would actually interfere with not just the right, but the ability to use solar energy. And what you're saying is that this is only the case if there are solar panels in place right now.
I could be wrong, but I thought we had discussed, and I don't actually think it was a part of this project that we had this discussion, but it was relatively recently, that the idea would be that the property owner would have to orient their solar in maybe a different orientation if they weren't already existing. Am I wrong? Or am I just making things up? Because that's entirely possible.
Chair Harper-Peterson, I don't particularly recall that discussion, that the solar panels, you know, could be, of course, that is the case. They could be reoriented or repositioned in a way where they could still capture the necessary sunlight for that unit.
Okay.
Would that address your concerns enough?
Well, I was sort of getting at an idea,
okay,
which was I've toyed with the third floor a little bit, looking at how it impacts different people, and I'm not sure if I moved it forward closer to the street, if it would have less of an impact on the neighbor to the north, but that would create a larger
facade.
A larger facade on Laurel Street, and take away the patio there,
right.
In which case you'd have a larger patio in the back, right. And I'm not sure that the neighborhood would want a larger patio in the back. And then I said, well, what if I moved that part of the third floor back, and that creates a larger facade in the back,
right.
With windows, and I'm not sure that the neighborhood would be thrilled with that either.
Okay.
So I was just, a piece of that was sort of the solar to the north.
I see.
And if you moved it forward, you'd have potentially more solar access and light to the property to the north. Not sure I'm ready to go in any direction there, but that was sort of what the question was directed at.
I see. That makes sense. Well, at this point, I guess before we actually start deliberating, does anybody have any other questions for staff at this point? Any clarification items?
Okay.
On the parking scenario, the drawings that showed how someone would park underneath, what kind of car was used for the model? Was that a small car or a large car?
We might have to get back to you on that information, but I can tell you that the parking internal circulation was reviewed by Hexagon, mm-hmm. an outside traffic engineering firm. So in a few minutes, maybe we can get back to you and give you some more information on that.
Okay.
Thanks.
Jesse, do you have a question?
Yeah, almost actually was a follow-up to parking. And I remember asking this last time, but I've been in 3.5 hours of meetings, so I don't remember what the answer was, but... it was in relation to when we're looking at parking. I mean, I know what the requirement is for residential in forms of bedroom and baths. How do we analyze the commercial element to it? I know there's a threshold, but are we using formulas as if it was a retail or if it was office? Because everyone's different, correct?
That's a good question.
That's correct. So it depends on the use that would be proposed inside the building. But there, since they don't have a user there, and because the spaces are small, they're less than 1,500 square feet apiece, the code says that there is no parking requirement for retail space under 1,500 square feet. So there's two spaces that... those two commercial spaces aren't necessarily parked there. And the intent of that is to add vitality to the downtown area. And it's really almost impossible for a small retail business or a two-story building or a one-story building to be built and provide the parking and make it economically feasible. So if a city is trying to add vitality and increase activity and retail diversity in their downtown, often what they'll do is they'll make these kinds of concessions for very small spaces. Otherwise, it just won't happen. And that's what we've done in the 600, 700, and 800 blocks of Laurel as well.
Let me...
I would have a follow-up
to
that.
Can I add something to that? And I know you might have, in case you haven't noticed in your staff report, just to kind of confirm, the required parking for the project is 5 spaces. As Al mentioned, the commercial spaces aren't required to have parking by virtue of their size. But, of course, there are parking requirements for the residential units. 5 spaces are required, and the project is proposing 7.
And I understand, if I read correctly, that there would be some shared use of the excess parking for employees but not for customers underground. Did I read that correctly?
That's correct. Okay. I believe there should be a condition. One of the conditions of approval is to require that the parking spaces be used, those 2 extra spaces are used for employees of the commercial spaces but not for patrons.
Got it.
So let me do a follow-up on that one, too. Because I think last meeting we talked a little bit about that. I know the threshold of 1,500 square feet, but I think it was the architect mentioned that because of that, they shrunk the sizes of the units itself, which is, I get what you're doing, but my concern is there's only one wall separating the 2 units. So what happens in a scenario where this commercial 2 separate units turns into 1 commercial unit? I mean, then we have a bigger parking problem.
Could that happen without?
Well, there's still
CUP?
A use. There's still a use issue, but I'm throwing a hypothetical out there because it's really just an opening in a wall.
Right. I see what you mean.
In response to that, if there was a subsequent tenant improvement down the years, where someone wanted to merge those 2 spaces together, they would be over 1,500 square feet and therefore subject to the parking requirements. Depending upon the use that would be, proposed for that space, they may or may not be able to meet the parking requirement by virtue of the 2 spaces that are below. The code does offer other provisions for meeting your parking requirement. It could be met off-site in a different location, but this is all, in theory, if something like this were to occur, they would need to find a way to meet the parking requirement. So when that, if that were to be the case, you know, they would have a meeting with staff and staff would go over the parking requirements to determine if that's something that would be feasible for that site, for the space.
Do you have any follow-up to that, or?
No, I think I exhausted that question.
Okay. Thank you. I do have an additional question surround, or I guess a question surrounding parking. Understanding that certainly the vitality and the walkability of Laurel is often what is used to determine the lower parking requirements for the commercial areas. My concern, and I think this is echoed from the last meeting, is that particularly the 900 block, and particularly Walnut immediately behind it, does have an excess parking challenge than a lot of the other areas of even Laurel Street. And so I'm wondering if there are other remedies that the neighborhood could pursue. And that doesn't necessarily mean that it would, I don't know if it would be conditioned with this project or not, but are there other remedies they can pursue with what is already an existing, legitimate existing parking problem in that particular block of Walnut and Laurel?
I mean, there's, you know, there's various areas around town that, you know, there's areas around schools, there's right. areas around the downtown, and sometimes there are more parking pressures in different neighborhoods throughout San Carlos, and that's historically been the case.
Right.
You know, I think that if there is a parking issue in a neighborhood, and we did a recent parking study and noted that, you know, that area of Walnut did have a little extra pressure. However, that's at certain peak hours of the day, and then there's other parts of the day where parking is available. So I think that if the neighborhood wants to approach the Public Works Department and talk about those kinds of remedies, we don't have some things like other cities, San Francisco or other larger cities have, where we, you know, put permit parking in a neighborhood necessarily, although we're looking at that for as part of the San Carlos Transit Village project for the east side in specific neighborhoods. So, but historically, we haven't done that. You could ask for hourly parking in your neighborhood, those kinds of things, but those are issues that you could approach the Public Works Department and then talk to the Transportation and Circulation Commission about.
But the neighborhood would approach that?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Al.
And through the chair, if I may, I'd like to follow up, if now is a good time, on Commissioner Bergman's question with respect to what size vehicle was used for the internal circulation for the underground parking. And this is included in your packet. There is the circulation study was prepared by, like I mentioned, Hexagon, and it's a report dated October 4, 2012. And the vehicle size used in the auto turn simulations was a large passenger car with standards consistent with the, I'm going to forget the acronym, but some of you may know it, with ASHTO, A-A-S-H-T-O, which is essentially a national standardized traffic and circulation guidebook, with the ASHTO 2001 standards. And it used a car that measured 7 feet in width and 19 feet in length.
Oh, my goodness.
Similar to a large SUV.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. David, do you have a question?
That's a couple. I think they're mostly technical.
Yeah.
So historically, when the zoning was changed for that block to the MUN, when approximately, and I'm not looking a year or close to a year is fine, when did that happen?
When the MUN designation?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
2 years ago?
The comprehensive
2009.
Update.
Would it be October 12, 2009, which is the date of the general plan?
No.
No?
Well, the zoning.
Afterwards.
Yeah, the zoning ordinance.
December
2011 is the date when the zoning ordinance was adopted.
So when that zoning ordinance was adopted, was there a finding that that zoning ordinance complied with the general plan?
No.
Yes, it would have to.
And the 811 and the 819 that we're talking about, those were 2009 general plan requirements?
Those are in the 2009 general plan, yes.
Okay. As far, there's been discussion of conditions of approval. Is there a doc? I mean, are we talking about the draft code compliance certificate, or is there some other conditions of approval somewhere, document somewhere else?
You are correct. It's the draft code compliance certificate.
Okay, so this is like super duper technical, but does it matter that it has a November 4th date? Do we actually need to change that to today's date if we approve it?
It would be changed to today's date.
Okay, and then frankly, I don't. The only thing that I see about the requirement that the landscaping be maintained is item 4 of the draft code compliance certificate. Is there something in there other than that that I'm missing? Because I'm not trying to trick anybody. I don't see anything in 4. It certainly requires that it be done consistent with the irrigation plan, and that that their irrigation system be installed. Does the plan say that it needs to be maintained in perpetuity? Because I just don't see anything about maintenance for perpetuity anywhere in the code compliance certificate.
You are correct, although the zoning ordinance sets forth that requirement, which applies to all projects that are undergoing design review.
Okay.
So it's even if it's not explicitly stated in here, it's still applicable.
And so that you're saying that I was just looking like Mr. Savay was going to say something, and he
just through the chair, if the commission wanted to explicitly state it here, you could do that.
I don't want to do something that's not necessary. I mean, if you folks are comfortable that that it's required, even though the code compliance certificate doesn't specifically say it, I don't need to add magic words. Everyone's comfortable that it's required?
It is required.
Okay.
And if I may, I stand corrected. I'm looking at the draft code compliance certificate, item 4.
Yeah.
Where it states that it needs to comply with all requirements of Chapter 1818 landscaping, okay. Which would include the maintenance,
okay.
Maintenance requirement.
Okay. Those were all of my questions.
Okay.
Thank you.
Scott, do you have any additional questions for staff at this point?
Actually, I have one more for the developer.
Can the applicant come up? And answer the question.
So I was trying to figure out how to make this a little bit less impactful on the neighborhood. And one of the things is that the office space is 16 feet and in height. And I wondered, I believe that's relatively standard.
That's pretty standard.
For office.
Sorry, right. Office space.
For office space is to have a 16-foot floor.
Oh, okay, right.
And I just wondered if anything could be done to shrink the size of that to, say, 14 feet or...
I think, from understood, at least from the exterior, there's a piece of the planning code that requires it to be at 16 feet. I think there's some sort of datum they're trying to maintain.
Yeah,
as far as
according to the report, it says the ground floor minimum height is 16
right.
feet.
16 feet.
Right.
Okay.
We would have shortened it to give more room to the units above, but that was built in.
Okay. Thank you.
I just have one small question. I noticed that the applicant would be paying affordable housing impact fees, and it's only a three-unit thing. I'm just wondering how that's calculated, or if we know what that is.
It's required. So, I don't have the resolution that adopted the formula in front of me, but there is a formula that has been adopted by the City Council that sets forth what that affordable housing impact fee would be based upon the units. And
it's
a formula that has been adopted by the Council.
I thought it was a unit-based. That's what I meant to say. I didn't say it very well. I apologize. Okay, and then I guess I have one more question, and I don't know how to phrase this any other way, but I know that I'd asked the applicant, and certainly I'd asked a question of Margaret Pye as to whether their situation was resolved. So I guess my question to staff is that something we could even legally require as a condition, that they come to some sort of agreement, or no? I honestly don't know. I'm curious.
No, you can require that the parties discuss the issue and attempt to come to an agreement,
okay,
but you can't require them to come to an agreement.
Got it. Thank you. And that's it for me. Does anybody have any additional questions of staff at this point? Okay. Seeing none, I'd like to go ahead and open it to deliberation. And I know we started talking a little bit in our questions, but I'd like to go ahead and open it up.
I just want to say something really quick because I don't want anyone to be surprised. When this came to me before, I think I was probably more opposed than anyone else on the dais because I felt like I couldn't make the findings required by the general plan. And I think I said that explicitly. Frankly, I don't think I understood what Ms. Porras was saying. She was trying to explain to me what I needed to understand, and I just didn't get it, which is why I asked the questions that I did a couple of minutes ago about the zoning change, right, and the compliance with the general plan. I spoke to Mr. Savay after that meeting, and he helped me, although, again, I should have understood when Ms. Porras explained it, but he helped me to understand that because the zoning was changed and a determination was made that the zoning change was consistent with the general plan, it makes it a little bit difficult to then look at this and say, well, then even though it doesn't meet the zoning requirement, even though it meets the zoning requirements, it doesn't comply with the general plan. I question whether the zoning requirements comply with the general plan, but that decision's already been made. So, I'm not going to be the impediment that I think that I was before. And I just want to let everyone know I do have some serious concerns about how the building scale compares. I mean, I agree with what people are saying. It is much, much larger than the things around it, but it does comply with the zoning requirements. In fact, it's not as big as the zoning allows.
Right.
So I just want to throw that out there.
Any other, Scott, any comments?
I agree with you. I would like it to be smaller. I'm not sure that the developer hasn't already brought it down a floor and has, you know, set back in both the front and the back, and I agree with you. I'd like to see it smaller. I'm just not sure that there's...
Like the concern is more with our zoning than with their project.
Yeah.
Okay.
That being said, there are a couple of things that I do want to see included as part of this, and one is that the landscaping should be installed as soon as possible. Two, that the landscaping for the project is for the life of the project, including the hedge on the balcony.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's a little piece. And then the third one that I'm toying with, and I would like to sort of see how others feel about this, is creating a conditional use permit for any restaurant that goes in there, because my concern is that back patio area could become a patio for a restaurant, and that is a concern if it leads to garbage and pests and things like that on the residential neighborhood in the back. And so instead of it just being a zoning administrator approval, I would rather see it come back to the Planning Commission.
Is that something that we can make a condition, Al or Lisa, that something, even if it's under the 12 chairs, come back to the Planning Commission if it's a restaurant or eatery? I just want to make sure we can actually do it.
Yeah, that's right. Why I brought it up for discussion.
You could put that as a condition of approval. As we mentioned before, if it was 12 chairs or less, it would be under the authority of the zoning administrator. Our code does allow the director to make decisions to refer it to a higher level of authority. So that would be a, you could condition the project that the use permit come before the planning commission, regardless of the number of chairs.
Okay, correct. Thank you. Shannon, do you have any comments or questions? We're done with questions, comments?
I'm a little concerned about the space underneath for parking and if people would opt not to use that parking and to park on the street, but I don't know if that would be a barrier, complete barrier.
Thank you. Jesse, do you have any additional?
No, I was with David last time, and I think I'm still there. I think it fits all the zoning requirements, but we deal with this in design review all the time. You know, it really needs to fit within the character of the area, and I think the massing is just too large. So from that perspective, yeah, I mean, it does fit criteria.
Right. Okay. Well, then I'm just going to go ahead and make a couple of comments before I ask for a motion, probably along the same line. I think the concerns around scale and transition are certainly legitimate. And I also do think it's a risk. It's a risk that it's going to be the first building. It's going to be seen. I admit there might be people driving by going, oh, my gosh, what did the Planning Commission just build? Just allowed to be built. On the other hand, I think that the character of all of Laurel, along with the intent and the context of the general plan and all the meetings that were had in building up to the plan, because I went through those. The South of Arroyo plan says pretty clearly that this is what they intended. Mm-hmm. And so I have a hard time from a general plan standpoint, and certainly from a zoning standpoint, since this definitely exceeds the criteria that we have established, in denying the proposal. And that's where I think, I mean, these are our two guiding documents, and I think, in my opinion, this fits well with what we intended.
I tend to agree, and I also think that the that what's been presented has been presented a quality plan, a quality building to go in there. I think that the designer did a good job and the architect did a good job with that.
I think the challenge would be more a concern with our zoning, not with this project. This project meets it.
And I mean, I'm going to say, I'm going to vote for this project, but I mean, I'll say for the record, I don't believe the zoning complies with the general plan, but I didn't participate in that vote. I wasn't here. Perhaps if I would have seen what folks saw then, I would have, you know, agreed that the zoning fits with the general plan. Sitting here right now, without having participated in those conversations, this is what I spoke with Mr. Savay about. He indicated this is exactly what was intended mm-hmm. for this area, and I get that, I appreciate that, and so I'm going to vote for it. But I'm very uncomfortable it. With yeah. it, extremely uncomfortable
Got
with it.
It. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thank you, commissioners, for your comments and concerns. What I'd like to do now is to entertain a motion for approval. It sounded like a motion of other sorts. And I'd like to make sure that the motion includes some of the provisions, assuming that we're on board with that. Can we put that motion up? Where on earth is it?
Okay, so we take these one at a time. I move that the Planning Commission approve the request for design review for the construction of a new three-story mixed-use structure at 934 Laurel Street, APN 051-357-180, based on the findings and for the reasons incorporated in the staff report, and as conditioned in the code compliance certificate with the following modifications. Condition number 20 would be that landscaping shall be installed as soon as feasible. Condition number 21 is that landscaping is for the life of the project, including the hedge on the balcony. item number 22 is that a conditional use permit would be required for any size restaurant.
A planning commission level CUP?
Conditional, yeah.
I would say planning commission.
Planning commission level conditional use permit.
Okay, great. Can I get a second for that?
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Nay for me, please.
I was just going to ask. So just to be clear, that's an aye for Commissioner Bergman, for me, for Commissioner Silberman, and for Commissioner Marsters, and a nay for Jesse. Why am I blanking? What is wrong
with me?
Call
me whatever.
I think his last name is Gutierrez.
Gutierrez for this guy, for Commissioner Gutierrez.
Jesse, if you could turn your name tag in this direction for us, that would be...
Here, let me help
you. Yeah, so we don't forget.
Thank you. Okay, and then can I entertain motion number two for the dirt hall?
I don't have any problem with that one. I move that the Planning Commission approve the grading and dirt hall certificate to facilitate the creation of the underground parking garage for the structure at 934 Laurel Street, APN 051-357-180, based on the findings and for the reasons incorporated in the staff report and as conditioned in the grading and dirt hall certificate.
Can I get a second?
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Yes. No.
Okay. So for the record, Commissioner Gutierrez opposes.
You got the name right.
I know. I apologize. Long day. Thank you all very much for your comments and concerns, and thank you for listening through this hearing. We do have another item, commissioners. I think now would be a nice time to take a very quick restroom break, because I don't think Branson will take very long, but you never know.
Find out.
Yeah. So if I can have everybody back in 5 minutes or under to discuss the last item, 800 Branson, that would be great.
I encourage my wife.
I was going to call him Commissioner Jesse. Everybody else gets a lot. Well, thank you all for bearing with us for the break. We are back, and I'd like to go ahead and hear item C under our public hearing, which is 800 Branston Road, and that's a design review for a sign permit for a new billboard on city property. Lisa.
Good evening. Thank you. Lisa Costa-Sanders, principal planner. As indicated, this is design review for a new billboard at 800 Branston. As recommended by the Planning Commission, the City Council recently introduced updates to San Carlos Municipal Code Sections 18.22 as well as 12.28, and that's to allow billboards on city property. Those two ordinances together do require Planning Commission review of a design review for the billboard, as well as City Council approval of a lease agreement. This project also includes the removal of a billboard located at 303 Old County Road, and that relocation agreement as well as lease agreement is currently scheduled for review at the December 9th City Council meeting. The application before you then is Clear Channel proposes to construct a new 55-foot tall billboard. This is Branston Road. The billboard would be located right here in what looks like a dirt path. When you do your site inspection, you notice it's got some gravel out there. And then this existing tree, at this point, they're proposing that it remain. But I've talked to them during the course of construction. If there's any issues, they would certainly work with the city to replace that tree. But it is proposed to remain at this point. As indicated, Branston Road, there's commercial buildings on either side at a height of 20 and 22 feet. And then this is Highway 101 southbound, northbound. And then there is a freeway sign right here, indicating the next exit. The proposed billboard itself would be 55 feet tall to the top of the billboard. The display area is 48 feet by 14 feet, and the clear underneath would be 41 feet above grade. So from grade to the underside of the billboard would be 41 feet clear. And then the pole is a brushed aluminum pole cover. As indicated in the staff report, the billboard is proposed to have images that would rotate every 8 seconds, and the regulations specify no less than 4 seconds. So they're having those images stay longer than the state regulations specify. So that would reduce any concern related to traffic safety. As well, the LED display, so the brightness of the display, they're proposing to limit that to 0.3-foot candles over ambient light measured from 250 feet away. And this is consistent with the Outdoor Advertising Act as well as the California Vehicle Code, which regulates brightness. The proposed billboard also complies with the separation requirement of at least 1,000 feet from another electronic message center. And then as well, it's consistent with the newly introduced Chapter 18.22, which specifies the 55-foot height limit, has the maximum size of 672 square feet per area, oriented towards the freeway and minimally visible from residential neighborhoods. The environmental review, we contracted with David J. Powers and Associates, and Julie Wright is here to review the environmental review as well as discuss the visual simulation that was completed. And following her presentation, I'll just close, and then we're both able to answer questions, and the applicant's here as well.
Great. Thank you, Lisa. Good evening, Chair and Chair Commissioners. As Lisa mentioned, my name is Julie Wright. I work for David J. Powers and Associates, and my firm assisted the city with preparation of the initial study and the mitigated negative declaration. All of the environmental impacts and mitigation measures included in the project are related to construction of the new billboard on Branston Road and demolition of the existing billboard at 303 Old Country Road. The environmental evaluation concluded that all impacts could be mitigated to a less than significant level. Besides the construction impacts, the other key environmental issue for the new billboard project was a change in the visual environment. As described in the initial study, the new billboard would not substantially affect the visual character or quality of the surrounding area and would not create adverse levels of glare or light. The proposed billboard design features and visual simulation photos were used to support this evaluation and conclusion.
Here's our first visual simulation that was done. This is looking sort of north at the billboard site with US 101 to the right. This is a similar view, but it's looking southward. And this view is across US 101 from Skyway Road. And this is a view from vehicles that would be traveling northbound on 101. And this final view is from the intersection of Branston Road and Industrial Road, looking at the billboard. And you can see from this this angle here that the display is not really visible. That's why it's directed toward 101. The next slide is a view from the closest residential area, which is looking in the direction of the billboard site, which is over 900 feet away. This is from Hall Street and Industrial. Our visual consultant who prepared all the previous visual renderings, we asked them when we were scoping this project, you know, the neighborhood, this is the closest neighborhood, is this a concern? So we have a visual rendering done here. And they, you know, looked at this area and they said there's just too many other things, the distance, the flat level area of the surrounding area, and also all the numerous trees and structures. So here you can see, here is the residential area where that photo is taken. Mm-hmm. And here's the billboard. And, you know, there's buildings here, here and here, and then obviously trees that you can see in that area that block it when you're on the ground from the residential streets. So that's why one wasn't done there. And then based on that, since, you know, the line of sight is predominantly blocked, that we determined in the CEQA environmental document that there would be no significant visual impact to the nearby neighborhood. And I think this concludes my presentation. I'll now turn it over to Lisa unless there's any other questions.
Could you go back to that last slide real quick? I know this is like terribly cynical.
Yeah, Polybius, okay. There we go.
Is the billboard just like right behind that tree?
No.
where would it be? I mean, because it looks like someone got on a giant scaffolding and took a picture of the tree.
Yeah, this is from Google Earth or Google Street View, so it's
okay,
obviously
fair
from
enough.
The car, you know what I mean?
Where would the billboard be if it were
would
there?
Be more this way. Yeah, because if you look, that tree is sort of probably here, and we're probably... If the view farthest in the distance adjacent to the tree is probably looking over here, what that tree is blocking is probably more this way, right over here,
okay,
in this area, which you couldn't even see. You'd be sort of blocking some of these buildings here. So we looked at it in different areas, and if this was up high, maybe you would be looking down, but we're not in that situation here, so.
Any other questions for Julie at this point?
Except that house on the corner is actually two stories. So you are up high on that particular house there.
Talking about the one across the street?
The one it's the one opposite side of the street there.
Yeah.
Is actually two stories.
Yeah, the one across the street from here is two stories.
And so when you say you can't see it from
the streets, the public streets.
The street.
Yeah, I mean,
It
is possible there might be a sliver or a piece of it that could be seen from maybe, you know, the second story if the windows are aligned right, or the rooftop, or maybe, you know, certain angles. But for CEQA purposes, we analyze the area from the public space, from the overall neighborhood, if it's going to be a substantial change or if that change would be significantly averse, and that wouldn't be the case if it was, you know, if they could point it out in the distance there. And so that's the reasoning why we wouldn't do a visual rendering from that location and our determination for less than significant.
Except that I think that in our package, in the thing that we sent to the city council, we actually talked about it not being visible and not a small piece of it.
Well, it isn't visible from the public area.
Yeah, but that's not what the...
And that's how we determine from the signal.
Why don't I have Lisa come back up? And I know that, yeah. A, maybe Lisa can answer the question better.
Sure.
And B, Lisa can also finish her presentation.
Thank you. The specific finding that was forwarded is that the billboard design and orientation takes into account visibility from surrounding residential neighborhoods. So you're not saying it's not at all ever visible, but that it take into account the visibility from residential neighbors. So as indicated from that second story, you could catch a glimmer of the top of it. Also keep in mind, it is not designed to be perpendicular to any of these buildings. It's at an angle kind of away from. So your line of sight, and I'm not going to guarantee you won't see any of it, but your line of sight is, you know, the billboard is kind of facing away from you. It's not angled right at your line of sight.
Because of the V.
Because of the V orientation.
So the visual impact is 250 feet in the nearest, 250 feet or yards, and then the nearest house or home is 950?
I believe you measured it.
The closest residence
is over 900 feet from the billboard site.
Okay.
Then why does your report say that there is limited visibility of the proposed billboard from the residential neighborhoods to the northwest? And then further on down, it says the maximum illuminance at a distance of 600 to 800 feet to the nearest residence off of Hall Street. So you're in one case, you're saying it's over 900 feet. In the report, it says 600 to 800 feet. And in one case, you're saying it's not it doesn't have any effect, but in the report, it says limited visibility.
Scott, can you cite the page number?
I can't guarantee that you're not going to be able to see it at all. So it could have some visibility, but it wouldn't be a significant impact.
Thank you.
So visibility, but low impact or no impact.
I'm sorry, attachment 6?
Yes, attachment 6.
Oh, attachment 6 was provided by the applicant, and he can certainly speak to that.
Okay. Well, Lisa, are you finished with your part of the presentation?
Yeah,
great, because we can always bring you up for questions.
Absolutely. Okay, and that attachment was provided by the applicant, so they'd be happy to respond to that.
Great. Well, why don't we go ahead at this point, then, bring the applicant forward, and then you can go ahead and make your presentation and then answer Commissioner Marster's question. Good question.
Good evening, Chair Harper Peterson, and members of the Commission. I'm Robert Hatton. I represent Clear Channel Outdoor. I'd like to thank Lisa and her colleagues for their thoughtful and thorough review of our application and for your consideration this evening. I don't really have a presentation prepared. I'm here simply to answer any questions that you may have for me.
Well, then I think this is the perfect time to answer Scott's question. And Scott, can you restate that for him?
Yeah, so I am just trying to figure out exactly what impact the billboard would have on the residential neighborhood.
I'm sorry.
I mean, your own report said that there's limited visibility, but that suggests that there is visibility from the residential neighborhood. And Lisa was talking about over 900 feet, and yet it's 600 to 800 feet in the report here.
I measured it myself this morning on using Google's Google Earth tool, and it was over 900 feet. And when we were assessing this site for the viability of the sign, we did go out there with a telescoping rod and raise it up to the height of the sign would eventually be. And I drove both directions on the freeway. That's our main concern, is making sure that it's effective for advertising. But then also along Industrial Road between Holly and Britton. And I was unable to see the telescoping rod from this particular location along Industrial Road. I think, generally speaking, you know, we wouldn't guarantee that somebody couldn't see. I've not been in the second story of any of those homes, so I don't know what they can see or not see. I can tell you, though, that from the line of sight that we've looked at and assessed, that we don't believe that there will be any impact on the residents of that neighborhood. I've actually also spoken to the president of the neighborhood association for that area, and he expressed no concern about this project.
Okay. Because they had a huge uproar over the In-N-Out Burger sign, and in fact, the sign itself actually had to be
reoriented.
No, they reduced the lighting 30% in order to deal with that. A couple of other questions. Why does the sign have to be 55 feet tall?
The tree directly adjacent to it is approximately 40 feet tall.
So if we remove the tree, could you bring it down to 34 feet?
Not in overall height. The adjacent the buildings in the surrounding area are
22 feet.
20 to 25 feet, I think. And so we would need to maintain some amount of clearance over those buildings in order to be seen from bypassing traffic. And in addition, there's also the Caltrans sign, which is on the freeway and would block the view were we to lower our sign substantially. However, I will say that I think we could lower it to 50 feet and not have any impact, only if that tree were removed, though. And that's, you know, not something that's within my power to
decide.
Whose property is the tree on?
Lisa, do you know? Or
the trunk of the tree, to me, appears to be on private property.
Okay.
The foliage shares some public right-of-way and private property.
Lisa, do you know the answer to that offhand?
Well, I'm relying on
that, sir. Okay, great. Okay. Didn't know if there was additional. Okay. Got it. Okay. Quickly, just speaking of illumination, because I know that's an important point, is there a way? I did notice, Lisa, in your report that Clear Channel had agreed to lower the illumination to what was the designation? I guess my concern is what is the level of illumination, and can that be adjusted or altered after the sign is put up?
We install an attenuator on the sign when it's constructed, such okay. that it is never operating at greater than 0.3 foot candles over
That's
the ambient
the
amount
candles.
Of light.
Thank you.
And that is an objective standard that members of the Planning Commission, citizens, anybody can go out there with a light meter, and if they stand 250 feet away, can make sure that we're operating within those standards that we have set. They also happen to be the standards at which we operate our other signs in this market and all over the country, for that matter. We have found that's a level that is below that of signs that you may have seen elsewhere on auto dealerships or on-premise businesses such as that are operating digital signs. Significantly lower than those type of businesses, and generally speaking, we've not gotten much feedback when we are operating within those parameters. But the main point is that there is an objective standard. You can go and measure it, and if we're above that, we are able to adjust it.
Absolutely. And I understand we have an existing sign at, and maybe this is a better question for staff, at Mozart. Do you know what foot candle that operates at? Or what?
when I researched the permit, it didn't establish what the brightness was.
Okay.
So I would need to follow up with them specifically.
Okay. Thank you. Does anybody else have any questions for the applicant at this point?
Go ahead.
Oh, no, that's okay.
Go ahead,
just from a scale perspective, because it's sometimes hard to figure out what 55 feet is and all that other stuff. You have another, well, it's probably not yours, but Silicon View that's near the building, the Circle Star, the old Circle Star area. How tall is that?
From grade level, I don't know how tall it is. I do know that the panel is 19 feet high, which is 5 feet taller than the panel that we propose. I'm sure, though, that that sign from grade level is at least, 40 plus feet, just given the topography around there.
I have potentially a question, depending upon the answer that the staff gives. I don't see the code compliance certificate requiring that the display change be no more than every 8 seconds. Is that just something that they have voluntarily indicated that they're going to do, or is that something somewhere else in the code compliance certificate?
Condition number 4.
I was looking for the number 8, and it's written out. There it is.
And then what I also put in there is unless in conflict, so if state regulations were to change, they would need to comply with that if it was a more restrictive state requirement.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you. So now I don't have a question.
Does anybody else have any questions for the applicant at this point?
One more, I think. So under the lighting controls, and this is in your attachment 6, page 7, you talk about the ability that it's feasible to specifically program the nighttime operation such that turning off the billboard between the hours of 12 a.m. to 5 a.m. is possible. Is that something that is potentially done after the billboard is actually installed? So if we get a rash of individuals complaining that the billboard's keeping them up at night, that's something that, and how do we, and this is a question for staff, how do we put that as part of the application so that if there are individuals?
So are you looking for some recourse or some language for approval
as
that if
part
there's
of
a
the
problem,
conditional use, if
back?
There's a problem that, you know, people are complaining about, that it comes back to the Planning Commission to solve that?
Okay. And that's a question for staff then?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry, I just wanted clarification.
I think this is sort of integral to the lease terms. And I seem to recall that there is some provision in the lease about that. So perhaps in your motion, you ask the council to look at that or instruct staff to make sure that we bring that to the attention of the council if that's a concern. But you know how the lease and the relocation agreement work hand in hand is that the lease will have a revenue share situation in it, and I want to make sure that whatever conditions you put on here are consistent with that. I don't have that in front of me, but that's kind of the comment I have about it. I think it's probably more appropriately covered in the lease anyway, because of the revenue share issue in the lease and the lease payments, and that it's still the city's property. It's a lease, so I think that would be the most appropriate way to handle it, in short.
Okay. This also might be more appropriately covered in the lease, but I did have a question about content, and I guess because it was a lease from the city, I was wondering if there would be opportunities then for the city to advertise certain city functions
on the billboard, or would that even be appropriate in the lease agreement?
There is a provision, such a provision in the
okay.
lease.
Great. Thank you, Greg.
And I just want to clarify. You said you could lower it to 50 feet and there wouldn't be any serious impact.
If we were able to.
Back to a tree.
Move the tree. Move the tree.
Right.
Okay.
You could.
There would be an impact to a tree, yes.
So that would be the discussion.
The serious possible impact on a tree.
Tree death.
Trees can move.
So what happens in 5 years when that tree, what happens in 5 years when that tree grows in front of the sign?
Well, we've had an arborist take a look at the tree, and we've been advised that it is, for the most part, mature. We've also considered the fact that with half of the tree blossoming, if you will, over the public right-of-way, that the city may grant us permission to prune it on occasion.
So I'm wondering if we could prune it and reduce the sign by 5 feet.
Well, if it's on somebody else's property.
I mean, the light impact is 250 feet, right? At 250 feet, the light impact is 0.3.
The measurement for the light output in foot candles is to be measured from 250 feet back from the sign. We're committing to not going over a threshold of 0.3 foot candles over the ambient light as measured from 250 feet away, but you will be able to see the sign if you're traveling on Highway 101 from greater than 250 feet away.
Right, on 101, but if you're back in the neighborhood.
If you're back in the neighborhood at 900 feet, you know, to the best of our judgment, you won't really be able to see the sign at all. But again, I have not been on the second story of any of those homes, so I can't guarantee that, and I wouldn't, I wouldn't guarantee it just because I haven't been able to. Well,
but you could see the sign from the freeway for over 1,000 feet.
You can make out the advertising content on the sign once you get inside of about 800 feet or so. Much beyond that, you know, my eyes can't determine. But yes, you will be able to see that there's a sign there from some distance away.
So just to get at kind of the crux of this, I'm sensing that tree apocalypse is not.
I'm not in favor of a tree apocalypse.
I'm not either.
But that obviously you were trying to find some way to reduce it in height just a tad, and it doesn't seem like there's a good resolution to that, or is there? And I guess would that be a question for staff?
That would be up to staff.
Going back to Scott's question then, could we prune the top of the tree enough?
But isn't it on somebody else's property?
Right, and if it is on somebody else's property, are we even allowed to do that?
That's probably the
correct.
I'm sure there's got a way that we can add to this motion that staff should explore whether or not the tree can be pruned in such a way that will maintain the tree and allow the sign to be lowered by 4 feet. I'm sure we can incorporate that in a motion.
Let me ask that question then. Can we incorporate that in a motion?
The only concern the only concern I have is just from a practical standpoint, since I did look at the survey, the trunk of the tree is on the other property, it's not on the city property, and this adjacent property owners, whether it's the city or anyone else, can prune a tree as long as you don't kill it.
Right.
I had an alternative idea when you were discussing it that maybe we just form a condition that instructs the applicant and the city to jointly go to the neighbor and see if they will agree to have the tree removed. And if the tree is removed, then the height would be the lower height. But if we can't agree in a reasonable period of time to do that, then we're going to have the pruning as the solution.
Yeah, that's why I suggested the word explore.
Yeah. I would not be in favor of removing the tree. I would be more in favor of pruning the tree. If it can be done.
It's just we'll have to get the city arborist to look at the tree to see if it can be pruned. And I have my doubts, just my experience with trees, that it'll be possible to prune the tree, the crown of the tree, when we don't own the tree. I could see us pruning the branches that hang over on our property. But there's a lot of issues that arborists will tell you about balance of the tree, and I mean, I don't even know the species of the tree. I asked staff what the species is, how long is it going to live, and you know, all those other things would be are always.
Glad I'm not the only one who asks those questions.
But you know, I think if the desire of the commission is to have the height of the overall top of the sign be 50 feet, give the staff just discretion. Well, actually, it needs to go to the city council anyway, so that might be where ultimately the issue is decided. So you could put a recommendation in that it be 50 feet with a provision of that the city will explore pruning options. And then by the time we bring the lease to the city council, we might have some better answers on the question.
Okay, I'm fine. I'm fine with that language.
How much is 0.3-foot candles? I mean, realistically, how bright is that?
How bright is it?
Yeah, give it like a light bulb bright, 60-watt light bulb bright, sun bright. I mean, approximately how bright is that?
It's measured from 250 feet away. A sign operating at 0.3-foot candles over the ambient light conditions, which is a key qualifier, does not, to my eye, look tremendously different than a traditional non-digital billboard, and that's kind of the goal. We don't want for these signs to look significantly different than traditional billboards. We just want to have the ability to change the copy remotely and more frequently.
Okay. Right.
So it's not going to look anything like the one at Circle Star?
The dimensions will be completely different, and the technology has advanced tremendously in the last, you know, several years. We did not install our first digital billboard in the Bay Area until 2010, although you have seen them driving, you know, in the region for probably at least a decade before that. The reason that we did not is that, you know, in our business, our clients don't like undue negative attention. And so we waited until the technology was mature enough for us to deploy. And the dimming capabilities that these signs now allow, as well as the image resolution, are such that they really, to my eye, traveling by them, don't look significantly different than traditional billboards.
Are you going to have motion on the billboard? One of the things that I find very distracting about, say, the Circle Star is, as you're driving along, there's like all kinds of things going on the billboard. So you're talking about changing it every 8 seconds, but within that 8 seconds, are things moving across the billboard? Or is it pretty much a static set thing for 8 seconds?
It's a completely static image for the entirety. In fact, it's illegal to have full animation on a digital sign at this point. So that may have been true, I think, of the Circle Star sign when they first installed it. They are no longer running fully animated images on that sign. And there's in addition, there's no transitioning. So you won't see a sign slide. You won't see one fade in, fade out. It's seamless.
Any other questions for the applicant at this point?
No.
Or for staff?
I have one more for staff.
Okay. No, that's okay.
So when I saw this coming, I asked the question about Palo Alto, because I know Palo Alto just decided that they were not going to approve a digital billboard. And so I was curious as to what their reasoning is as to why they chose not to approve a billboard. And I think one of the things that I saw was the idea of billboards visually take your eye off the road for more than 2 seconds, and anything that does that tends to impact the safety of driving. And so I was kind of curious about that aspect of it. And then there was another thing that I looked up about the National highway regulations, and those are being challenged in court. And what happens if we put this billboard up and then those regulations are overturned?
I can answer the Palo Alto question. I'll let Greg answer the other question. I spoke with the planning director in Palo Alto, and that was a very unique location, as he indicated, where the billboard's proposed is right adjacent to Greer Park, right across from the wetlands. So it's in a large, more open space. It's not in between any other commercial buildings. So it was very out of character to have a billboard in that location. And he indicated that's why the city council decided not to pursue it. It was an opportunity for city revenue. So it was something the city manager put forward as an opportunity site, and the city council said it's just not an appropriate location given, you know, the park-like setting as well as the wetlands right across, the proximity to the bay, and no other buildings anywhere close to it. So that was the reasoning for that. And Greg, the other question?
I'm not entirely familiar with that, but I, as maybe many of you know, I've been involved in some billboard litigation in San Carlos, and it's probably a free speech issue. It's probably my guess. But we're going to handle the regulation of this billboard through our through the lease. We have a lot of very particular provisions that are in the lease that deal with how the billboard is going to be operated, and because it's our property. Whereas a lot of the billboards that you see out there are not on city property, they're on private property, and so the city doesn't have as much control over the use of the property.
Okay. Lisa, you brought up across from the wetlands. How close is this to the Bear Island Preserve out there? And does it, the billboard, as far as being across the freeway from that area out there?
Yeah, I need an aerial. It's north. Yeah, I believe there's buildings directly across the freeway. Yeah. Yeah, there's buildings in the airport directly across the freeway, so it's not directly across the Bear Island, similar to where the Circle Star is directly across from Bear Island, the wetlands area. So we still have structures on the other side of the freeway.
Yeah, that's what I understood as well.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Any other questions for staff or for the applicant at this point? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Since this is a public hearing, I just wanted to mention I do not have any speaker cards other than, of course, the applicant who has already spoken. But I do want to note for the record that we did receive written correspondence from Patty Marsters in opposition to the sign. So I just wanted to make that note for the record.
Did she have a question? Or
And since that was the only written correspondence and seeing no speaker cards, I'd like to go ahead and, I guess, entertain a motion to close public comment and then deliberate. Or
so moved.
Great.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Okay. Any additional deliberation or comments from the commission at this point about the sign on Branston?
No.
Anything? Okay. I have nothing either. Scott, anything before we vote?
Nope.
Okay. Great. Well, then can I go ahead and entertain a motion?
Motion. I move that the Planning Commission adopt the resolution for approval of the mitigated negative declaration associated with the proposed installation of the new LED billboard at 800 Branston Road based on the findings and for the reasons incorporated in the prepared initial study / mitigated negative declaration and staff report.
We want to add that other.
I think not to the environmental review. I think we'd add it to number two.
Second.
Yeah.
Okay. Then may I get a second for motion number one?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Nobody opposed? Thank you. And can I get a motion for number two?
Finish it off.
Okay. I move that the Planning Commission approve the design review associated with the proposed installation of a new LED billboard at 800 Branston Road based on the findings and for the reasons incorporated in the staff report and as conditioned in the design review certificate.
Do you have a condition? Is that it?
I can make a friendly amendment when you're done, if you like.
Okay.
in the design review certificate?
I would offer a friendly amendment that we include in the motion that the staff explore with the applicant and, if applicable, any neighboring landowners, whether or not the tree that is adjacent to the proposed billboard can be trimmed in a way that will allow the billboard to be reduced to a height of 50 feet.
Okay. Can I get a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
No.
Oh, I was just going to ask if opposed. Thank you, Scott. Okay, so that's Commissioner Marsters opposing. Great. Okay, motion passes. Thank you all very much. And that is the end of our public hearing items. We are going to move on now to reports, correspondence, and general information. And can I have a report on recent city council actions?
Yeah, please update us.
Thank you, everybody.
Madam Chair, the city council considered the Transit Village over two meetings, which concluded just a week or week and a half ago or so. The city council, I guess the bottom line is they voted 4-1 to approve the Transit Village project. However, what they approved was, I think, fairly different than what the Planning Commission had recommended, in that after the first study session of the City Council, the staff recognized that there were some significant issues with regard to traffic, height, mass, density from the City Council. So what staff did is we tried to synergize what we heard at the study session, and we came back with some alternatives. One of the alternatives was the Planning Commission recommendation. One alternative was to reduce the mass of some of the buildings and in certain locations. And a third alternative was to reduce the height of Building 8 from 3 stories to 2 and eliminate additional units. And so the unit counts of all three were different, of all three alternatives. The alternative, for instance, by the Planning Commission was for 272 units, let's say. One alternative was around the 260, 265 range, and another was in the 250 range. So we gave the council a number of alternatives. At the end of a long night of deliberations after the second meeting, as the council was deliberating, a motion was made to accept the alternative that would reduce the height of Building 8 from 3 stories to 2 stories and to go to the lower density of 250, let's say. That was countered by a motion from the mayor that would reduce the entirety of all the residential buildings to 3 stories and reduce the mass of Building 8 to 2 stories, and that's what passed on a 4-1 vote. Mm-hmm. So that kind of synergizes everything that happened. I can certainly answer questions.
Thanks for that play-by-play.
And what was the unit count on that?
Well, with the reduction in total,
33?
It would be 236. Mm-hmm. However, that's one of the things that we're kind of struggling with now is, that's 236 based on simply removal of units from a third story. But the other issue is the unit count important or is the mass important?
So, yeah, which ones?
So that's something that we're talking about now in how to come back with what the council intended.
Right.
And I'm, you know, so we're trying to figure that out, because if it's 3 stories now and the mass is no longer an issue, and there was some concern, I suppose, about density. Should the unit count be allowed to go higher than 236 to allow for, you know, more units to make it more economically feasible? So that's kind of what we're struggling with at this time.
And how does that clarity get determined?
Well, I guess with the City Council, we're going back to the City Council this next Monday night with all the ordinances and the planned development project, and that's one of the issues that we'll be addressing in the staff report.
I guess my concern, and I think that's maybe something that we'll address in design review, is I know that certainly the quality of the build, I wouldn't want to see the quality of the building reduced as a way to make up for the lower unit count or the lower story count. Last thing I want to see is a flatter building with no insets and no public plazas to make up for the unit count. And I guess that's just something I want to say. That's not a compromise. A flat, ugly building, yeah. A series of buildings is not something I would like to see, and I'm sure that's not what the council intended. So I don't know. I don't know what to say beyond that, but I guess I just want to make sure that we then push on our side as a commission during design review to really keep pushing for quality of the building and of the design.
Yeah, and I echo that. You know, staff has that same concern. Because of the significant reduction in the scale and mass of the development, it may not pencil economically at this point, and right. What the Planning Commission may see is a completely different design
right,
for some
yeah.
of the buildings. And I think your concern is, you know, right on the money. And so that really is a reality at this point, and we won't know. The developer has really had to go back. I think they're going to have to go back to the drawing board.
Right.
Because, you know, the cost of underground parking and such, you know, it's just very expensive. And if you don't have the units to support that kind of construction, you know, it just may tip it into a different type, a different model of development. So with that in mind, it could be that you do see something different than what we've seen all along in terms of the type of construction, type of development. But the design is of the utmost importance, whatever comes forward.
Yeah, thank you, and I agree. I would hate to see us lose significant view corridors and significant insets and significant articulation. Though I obviously
Madam
don't.
Madam Chair, know can we else. Just not talk about this anymore tonight?
Sure. Yes, we can.
Since we're going to be
talking about it.
Design review in the future. I just I tried to give you some leeway, but I think we'll just stop right now.
Fair enough. Great. Thank you. Moving on to item B: Planning Commission comments or reports.
I just want to note for the record that if there is a meeting on December 4th, I will not be here.
Thank you. Any other planning commissioner comments or reports? Mm-hmm. Correspondence?
Staff has no other correspondence other than was provided to you for the items that were presented tonight.
Thank you. Planning staff comments, reports, and updates on current projects.
We were able to get through quite a number of projects these last couple of rounds. We still have some items to bring back to the Planning Commission. One includes a proposal for additional water tanks on Melendi and Crestview Drive, proposed by Cal Water. That'll be an item that hopefully we can get to you before the end of the year, pending some additional items that we need to review. And there's also a two-lot subdivision and design review project. I believe it's either on Club Drive or Crestview Drive. I'm sorry, I don't recall the address, but that's another item that should be on its way to the commission.
Great. Thank you.
Did you say Melendi and Crestview in the first one?
Correct.
Melendi
Water
Tanks?
Okay.
Correct.
Great.
Yeah.
There's one on Melendi, one on Crestview.
Well, there's two sites.
That's correct. There are two sites. One is on Melendi, one is on Crestview, both proposed by Cal Water.
Okay.
Thank you. All right, seeing nothing else, I'd like to go ahead and adjourn this meeting at 9:58. Thank you very much, everybody.
Boy.
Thank you.